3, 2, 1. We have ignition. Strap in.
Straight Talk with Matt Hasley. Every Monday and Friday, 9 p.m. Central Time. Only on Armed Radio Global.
Sir, the attitude is not going to speed things up any bit at all. I'm going to ask you to speak into the mouthpiece very clearly.
Check this out.
Is Monday night. Time for some Straight Talk. It's your host, Matt Hasley. Tons of stuff in the news. We got PGA Tour first event. We also have Major League Baseball postseason. NFL. Just can't get it. They just don't understand it. And we have Wednesday night, the debate coming up. And more WikiLeaks. Or is it? So, special thanks to our sponsors out there, E24.com. Have you ate yet? Log on to E24.com. Download that app for your favorite mobile device. Click, order, and eat. It's like a food truck in your pants. Really, it's that easy. Also, HotSauceVault.com. Call Louie, or check out Louie at HotSauceVault.com. He will get you the hottest of the hot, or get you some of that wimpy to the wimp sauce if you need it. But it's, I got everything. Gag gifts, you name it. Check them out. HotSauceVault.com. Also, Lyft, L-Y-F-T. Need a lift somewhere? Well, log on to Lyft. They'll get you there. First event of the year. PGA Tour is in the books now. The Safeway Open. It was at Silverado Resort and North Napa, California. Silverado Resort and Spa. North Napa, California. Sounds weird to say that, but North Napa. But they had felt bad for Patton Kizzeri. I'm not sure if I'm not pronouncing it right. Or Kizzeri. K-I-Z-Z-I-R-E. He leading his first tour event and... I mean, he didn't blow it, you know, completely, but he shot 70 in the last round and ended up losing by one. Brendan Steele birdied his last three holes to win by one. He just could not control the driver. That's nerves, but I tell you what, he's right there. Who knows? Maybe he'll win again. I'd love to see him do it. I hate to see a guy, lose a tournament, but I mean, I don't consider him completely losing it or blowing it, whatever like that. But there were also four tied at 16 under. You had Paul Casey, Michael Kim, Scott Piercy, who shot 62 in the first round. He ended up finishing tied for third, and Johnson Wagner. And then Kevin was 15 under, and then you had a handful of them at 14 under, including Phil Mickelson. So a good event. You know, you like to see the first event of the year go off. Three under was the cut. So you got to play. As I said, pars won't cut it. Also, in Tiger Woods announced his new TGR brand. He says, say hello to TGR. It's what Tiger Woods has described the next step in his evolution as a competitor off the course. He announced Monday on his website, tigerwoods.com. A new brand identity and a strategy for his various ventures. In replacing the TW brand he used for and worn for years, Wood said that his new logo, which depends, depending on your perspective, looks like three triangles. A tiger's paw with stripes or an abstract negative space W. It says mindset to be the absolute best, method inspired by precision, with the end goal of elevating standards to the status quo. Mastery, that naturally results from focus and willingness to keep learning. Wood said on his website, my team and I have applied these principles to all that we've accomplished over the last 20 years, but I believe the beginning is, or I believe this is just the beginning. So TGR, the TGR label will include ventures such as involvement in various events, including two official PGA Tour events, the Quicken Loans National and the Genesis Open. His golf course design company, his restaurants in Jupiter, Florida, and the Tiger Woods Foundation, which has helped more than 145,000 students. During a town hall meeting with his staff in Anaheim, California, in early September, Woods indicated the new branding, an outlook in part of long-range future. The 40-year-old Woods has not played a tour event in 14 months following his back surgery. So I'm hoping that, yes, it's great that he's going to start TGR brand, but I hope it doesn't keep him from playing. Hope his time is not totally consumed by this company. I mean, it's hard to run, you know, a major company like he wants to run and be the best, you know, and devote time to playing golf because it's just too tough. There's too many things going on. They had the first Driver for Driver episode. I don't know if you got to see that. Some interesting concepts of people with drivers. A lot of people that I was surprised that submitted drivers that had no clue of the USGA rules. You know, I thought that they would have at least made the clubs all to where they say, hey, these have to conform by USGA and RNA rules. And if you don't know what USGA is, United States Golf Association, RNA is the Royal and Ancient Club of St. Andrews. They work together on determining the rules of golf. So I think that it would have been smart of them. And I understand there were some people that were, you know, rocket scientists and different stuff. And what it is they picked 11 finalists. Brian Urlacher is on the show, which is pretty cool. And they picked 11 finalist teams, and those teams went and pitched. They got 3 minutes to pitch their design to all, you know, to the people. And they had a panel of three that they, and what they did was they went and pitched whatever design it was, whatever, and what a lot of them, just by quick questions, were pretty much blown out of the water. A lot of them didn't realize that they had to do is conform to USGA rules. So, and finding that out, some of those designs are just null and void. I don't think people realized what they were doing. It's cool. I think it's going to help Wilson. It's going to help get them, back in the, you know, major market share, hopefully. I'd love to see him back there. I grew up, Wilson was it. I mean, I got friends, one friend of mine, he still works, he's one of the regional directors for Wilson. Great guy. I mean, I've known Wilson all my life. Good company located in Chicago. I like to see him do well. I like to see him do his, get that star power. Because, you know, if you don't have a tour presence, and that's a bad part of it, and I think that was the biggest downfall. You know, I mean, it was nice when they wanted to help out the assistant pros and staff them all with clubs and everything. But your assistant pros don't sell clubs. It's the guys on tour. I mean, it's just like NASCAR. NASCAR guy wins in a, you know, in a Chevy or a Ford or whatever it is, or, you know, product. The next day they sell so many whatever Chevy cars because of NASCAR. They drive the brand. Well, same way with, you get a guy, it's like when Freddie Couples wore a pair of Echo shoes in the Masters the 1 year, and it was a style they were discontinuing. After everybody saw them, it went crazy. Everybody wanted them. They had to relaunch that style. So I said, you know, that's the thing is these tour guys, Bubba Watson played the pink driver, went crazy. Everybody wanted the pink driver. It's what these guys are playing, people want. already got a guy that wants the new bag, the new Titleist bag for next year, and I'm trying to get it. It's not even available yet. The tour guys have it, but the regular person is not, is not available for sale. And he's already asking me, what's the price for next year? Blah, blah, blah. I don't know. It's not even available yet. I've talked to my reps about it, and they're waiting to find out what the price is going to be, sometime in, January, February, February of the show. Or end of January, early February, they'll be putting them out and be available for sale. But, yeah, it's golf business is tough. It's, it's evolving. I'd love to see Tiger get back to help, drive the sales of the, help out. But, for him to push the brand. Somebody asked me, do you think he's going to, take over the Nike club thing? I said, no, I don't think so. I'm surprised and not surprised he got into his own brand. I'm surprised because the golf business is very tough. He's got the money and the backing to be able to do it, to make it, top line stuff, to come on the market as a no name, to, design your own clubs for people to buy. That's tough to do. It's hard to get your foot in the door. So, Major League postseason, Major League Baseball. My Cubs got beat last night. Clayton Kershaw they couldn't do anything he pitched great. Cubs gave, Hendricks gave up one bad pitch, home run. They got beat 1-0. Jansen, their closer, came in, pitched six out closer. Had to get six outs to do it, 8th to 9th. You got to give hats off to them. They played great. The only thing I had problems with is Eric Cooper, the home plate umpire, strike zone was a little weird all night. Not saying it was just against the Cubs or anything, but it would be pitches that look like they're just dead over the plate, and he wouldn't call them. The one he called on Bryant in the 9th inning really got me. It was about a foot outside the plate, in towards Bryant being right-handed. It was about a foot off the plate in on him, and he still called it a strike. They showed it, the replay, and it was at least a foot. That's the only thing I don't like about it's hard to do is judge balls and strikes looking over the guy's shoulder, because when the catcher moves, it's hard to determine where the plate is still when the catcher's moving back and forth. It's a tough job to be able to call balls and strikes, but I know his dad personally, so next time I see his dad, I'm giving his dad an earful, because his dad has always gave me an earful in the shop. So, yeah, I can't wait till I see his dad next time. But yeah, I had some friends of mine that were at the game, and they said it appeared to be off from where they were, their vantage point, and they got those giant jumbotrons out there, and they replay just about every pitch for him, and it was like this huge, jumbotron up there showing that it was like a foot off the plate. The one guy I saw him, he was dead behind home plate, and he was an older man, and he was going off giving Cooper an earful, and great. I think when they're wrong, they should be able to be subject to ridicule. The umpires make bad calls. They should be subject to getting, ridiculed. What I don't like is, they tell him, oh, you don't criticize the umpires, otherwise they'll fine you. Okay. Well, it's got to be tough to sit there and not say a word. So, well, I'm going to get into that about criticizing stuff in the NFL. But currently, Cleveland Indians are playing the Toronto Blue Jays. Right now it's 2-2. Let me see. Do a little refresh there. It was 2-2 bottom of the fifth. Right now it's 4-2 Cleveland bottom of the sixth. I want to say I think Cleveland is up 2-0 in that series right there. So it's, I just got to update. Oh, well, you know, I don't want to see Cleveland. Well, I guess if they sweep them, oh well, whatever. They'll have to wait for you know, whoever wins the National League to sit in the, you know, wait for them at the World Series. If they sweep Toronto, they're already up 2-0. If they sweep Toronto, then maybe they'll get tired waiting for them. Get out, kind of get stagnant, you know. Bauer had to leave in the first inning after he blood was seen dripping from his one finger. He apparently injured his hand rebuilding a model drone, I think it was. So he had cut his finger. So they had pushed his start back. He had cut his right pinky on a drone last week, they said. He received stitches, but I don't know why they just don't, you know, crazy glue it. That always seemed to work out. So, you know, it's Cleveland's doing good with him being out injured. So, you know, maybe they're going to get a break because of it. And NFL. Oh man, my Bears. My Bears are so bad. There was a guy in the shop. Bears are up 10. Guy's in the shop and he says, "Oh, looks like the Bears are gonna pull one out." I think maybe they were up take the back. They were up 9. I said, don't jinx me like that. Guy kicks a field goal. Not shortly after the guy said that. And the next set of downs, I said there's still like 4 minutes left to go. I said, there's a lot of time, you know. Next set of downs, the guy throws a bomb. The guy doesn't even tackle him. He goes for all the way down for a touchdown. Bears lose 17-16. I'm like, there was still 2 minutes and 49 seconds left. So in 2 minutes, they'd scored 10 points and took the lead. I went to leave. I backed out, and I won't mention his name, but he's sitting out in his car getting his clubs in. And I backed up and wound on my window. I said, "You jinxed him." I said, "Right now, the Bears are losing 17-16. And he was like, "You're kidding me." I said, "Nope." I said, "Snatched from the jaws of victory. That's the Bears." I don't know what it is. They just can't seem to get anything going on. Right now, the NFL is going. You got Jets are getting beat 14-3 by, I want to say, oh, Arizona Cardinals. But NFL has been complaining about why their lack of viewers, you know, the viewing is down. I had a lady come to me. I was talking to her. And she said, she showed me this article about NFL, you know, the viewing, you know, down so many percentage points or whatever like that. And she says the reason why she quit watching it and doesn't watch all the other games is because of all the stuff of Kaepernick, you know, doing it, taking a knee and everything like that. So people are pissed about it. There's tons of people that are upset about it. So, you know, people don't, you know, they think, oh, okay, yeah, that doesn't mean much. And NFL is trying to deny, they're trying to ignore what the problem is. They're thinking, oh, well, if we just ignore it, they'll, you know, and just talk about other stuff, that they'll come back to the game. No, people are tired of it. You fine people for stupid things. You got a guy twerking in the end zone, you fine him. You got a guy you know, wears a pair of shoes with 9/11 on the side of it, you fine him. The guy's shirt comes untucked and he doesn't tuck it back in, you fine him. I mean, if he's got some, you know, something that makes him individually express himself, you fine him. But you got a guy like Colin Kaepernick who's individually expressing himself and you don't do anything. Because you're afraid of the politically correct backlash. It's fine if he wants to make a statement. Do it on his own time. They had a singer that was singing the national anthem at an NBA game, knelt down at the NBA game during singing the national anthem on a breast cancer awareness night. The people that were putting on the breast cancer awareness night were so upset because it was not, now it became not about breast cancer awareness. It became about this singer that wanted to do is put herself on stage and kneel down. I mean, it's gone to the point where you got kids in high school doing it. You got kids in high school doing walkouts. Because our mainstream media wants to sensationalize and make it to where they don't tell you the whole truth. You know, they don't talk about the or report it that individual had a gun. I'm not saying there's not bad cop shoots. There are, of course. There's going to be. But to sit there and they want to do... They want pictures of them stomping on cop cars and all this and burning down buildings because it sells. That riot and rage. They bring that on. If the cameras weren't there and they walked away from most of those people would go away. Is rioting and burning down a CVS, is that going to do is resolve or make changes to the issues? No. Is it going to make people that you want people to come help you to resolve the issues? Is it you think they're going to come help you when you do that? No. Most of the people that were doing damages in like Ferguson and Wisconsin and all that and Baltimore, they don't live there. They're brought in there. They're brought in there to create a problem. We're going to talk about that too, about people being paid to create problems. I mean, it's sad to see what people do and to try to influence somebody. Apparently, I think I mentioned that. Oh, I did want to mention before I got out of NFL, Dallas Cowboys with Dak Prescott behind the helm beat the Green Bay Packers by 14 in Lambeau Field. Gotta love it. Gotta love it. I am a Bears fan, and I'm for anybody who plays against the Packers. When you're a Bears fan, you hate the Packers, and I hate them. And I hate it even worse that my sister is a transplant Packer fan. Never paid attention to football growing up. Grew up in a Bear household and defected. Well, we don't want her back. Stay over there. So, but it was so nice to see. And I haven't harassed her about it yet. Because I know if I do, I'm just going to get the two letters F and U back. So, but with NFL, hard to believe, week 6. But I don't know if you noticed or saw the headlines. WikiLeaks, Julian Assange, who has been held up in France, his internet was cut off purposely severed to where he could not expose any more, any more gems or whatever you want to call it. But he had planned for this. He said, it says WikiLeaks has activated contingency plans after its co-founder internet service was intentionally cut off by state actors. The media organization said in a tweet, Julian Assange's internet link has been intentionally severed by a state party. We have activated the appropriate contingency plan. So they thought about this. They knew this was going to happen. It said the internet is one of those few, if not only, available ways for Julian Assange, who's been locked up in an Ecuadorian embassy in London for more than 4 years, to maintain contact with the outside world. Facing extradition to Sweden over allegations of rape, which he denies, the Australian computer programmer has been holed up in an embassy in West London since 2012. He claims the extradition is actually a bid to move his jurisdiction from which he can then be sent to the U.S., which is known to be actively investigating WikiLeaks. The unverified claims of sabotage comes as WikiLeaks continues to release damaging documents, most recently thousands of hacked emails from Hillary Clinton's campaign manager, John Podesta. They interviewed Martha Raddatz, she ran in the last debate. She interviewed Tim Kaine. And Tim Kaine, I'm like, okay. She interviewed him about the attack the Democratic Party had on Christians, about mocking them and stuff like that. And she asked if there should would it be an apology forthcoming? And he says, apology for what? And she says, you know, for the mocking of Catholics and the treatment of Catholics and Christians. And he says, well, I think those emails were hacked and altered. And Martha Raddatz said, well, the person who sent the email admitted to sending the email. So, and still Tim Kaine would not admit that they had been legitimate emails. Even after the guy who was the sender of the email, Martha Raddatz, told him that it was a legit email. And he still denied. He thought it was hacked and altered. The deny game is ridiculous in the Clinton case. You get caught, caught with a hand in the cookie jar and, oh, what, me? I don't know what you're talking about. So, they got other emails that have supposedly come out. It says, apparently John Podesta, he had a sick reaction to the San Bernardino. It says, apparently from the WikiLeaks emails, immediately upon receiving the news that the gunman responsible for the San Bernardino terror shooting, Hillary Clinton Chairman John Podesta suggested would be better if the person was American name had not had done the shooting. So they thought if it would have been American name, it would have looked better for their case. Because all they want to do is they want gun control. They want to be able to do, but it's hard to sit there and justify gun control when they have, Muslim names that are involved. But they're looking for trying to do is they don't care about, they want to further the agenda. It doesn't matter how. So, but I have some, let me see here if I can get the audio here. So, speaking of WikiLeaks, this is CNN, and CNN comes out. It says it's unlawful for the public to search the emails on WikiLeaks.
interesting is, remember, it's illegal to possess these stolen documents. It's different for the media. So everything you learn about this.
No, it's not different for the media. It's just as illegal for the media to have stolen documents. He's full of crap. He doesn't know what he's talking about. So for you to search and read an email, it's not any different than it is for him to search and read it. Why would it be any more legit for him to do it? For you to sit there and read a hacked email, I'm sorry, it's up there for the world to see. But if it's illegal for you to hack the email, but why would it be okay for them to search it? Yeah, they don't call it the Clinton News Network for nothing. I mean, it's ridiculous. So here, I'm gonna play that one more time.
Also interesting is, remember, it's illegal to possess these stolen documents. It's different for the media. So everything you learn about this, you're learning from us. And in full disclosure, let's take a look at what is in there and what it means. Joining us.
So in other words, it's okay for them to possess the documents. That doesn't make any sense. And talk about. Wow. So in other words, all the stuff, what we got coming up Wednesday, got the debate round three. Chris Wallace or whatever is going to be doing the moderator. We'll see how this goes. I wonder if Hillary backs out before it. There's rumor had it that she may just drop out before it. They're also talking about rumors that she has a bed in her van that she rides around in case she needs to lay down or whatever. But so here's the one. This is exchange. This is my favorite part of the exchange from Donald Trump and Hillary in debate round two. Oh, it says, sorry, this is only available to view in the UK. Well, It was the audio. I'd listened to it earlier. Now it's funny. It won't let me play it now. But it was the audio when Hillary said, well, it's a good thing that Donald Trump doesn't run, you know, the law in the United States. And he said, yeah, that's right, because you'd be in jail. So, I mean, you think about what is going to happen in round three? Well, there was a stories come out where I saw one, and this lady's been claiming for 30 years that Hillary raped her. Drudge is promising that a Hillary sex bombshell is going to be coming out. That came out, that was on Drudge, so I don't know when that's gonna land, but it should be pretty soon. Here's another one that it won't get much airplay, won't get any new mainstream media news because they'll ignore it. Hillary called her black servant the N-word, claimed former Clinton chef. It says, Tracy Martin drops a bombshell during a radio interview. It says, Hillary Clinton angrily referred to a black servant as the N-word, according to Tracy Martin. He worked under the first Clinton administration. Martin's LinkedIn page features a photograph of him shaking hands with Hillary Clinton and includes details of how he cooked for numerous heads of state, including Margaret Thatcher, Helmut Kohl, President, and Mrs. George H.W. Bush. Martin claims the incident occurred during a private function at Elizabeth Taylor Medical Center in Washington, D.C., prior to the public engagement between Hillary Clinton and Bernadette Chirac, the wife of former President Jacques Chirac.
gentleman of color came in with something, and it did not please her the way it was. And when he walked out, she says that, and then she used the N-word. Martin told WBEN 930 radio host Tom Burley. He says, so you are alone with Hillary after the black guy brings in something and Hillary doesn't like it, and she says to you that N-word, Burley asked. And Martin said, yes. So he also went on to say, he said, according to Martin, the Clintons made racist comments on a routine basis, and the incident didn't come as a great shock to him. They think nothing of it because there's no press around. And you've been there with them long enough, whether it's with the Clintons or with the Kennedys or whoever, once they feel comfortable with you, their guard is let down, said Martin. Within 40 hours of doing the interview, Martin claimed that his phone was hacked and his apartment was broken into at 3 a.m. Isn't that great? Once you sit there and you go live about this stuff, they attack you. Host Tom Burley also said that after the interview, his loved one received odd voicemail messages from a phone number that was later revealed from the WikiLeaks dumps to come from within the DNC. The notion that Hillary Clinton is a closet racist isn't much of a stretch. After all, she called black people super predators and once praised Robert Byrd as her mentor. Byrd was a founding member and a leader of the chapter of the Ku Klux Klan. Her husband Bill also expressed his anger that Ted Kennedy was endorsing Barack Obama in favor of Hillary by belittling Obama because he was black. A few years ago, this guy would have been getting us coffee, Clinton told Kennedy. While Martin's claim is merely an accusation, there is no audio-video evidence to back it up. The mainstream media has afforded blanket coverage to similar accusations against Donald Trump. There is no audio-video evidence to verify the accusations made against Trump by numerous women who claimed that they were sexually assaulted by him, but the media has given those women a platform anyway. Will the media dare touch this story? Will they dare to give Tracy Martin a platform to reiterate his accusations that Hillary Clinton angrily called a black servant the N-word? Heck no. They'll never get out. They'll never talk about it. They feel the black vote owes them. Look what I put in your hand. I gave you this. Here, it's me. I did this for you. You need to pay me back and vote for me. Because the Republicans are racist. Pfft. No. I think Donald Trump will do more for the black community than anybody. Even Farrakhan says, for Obama, you screwed it up. Donald Trump, let him do it. He'll do a lot better off. I think he's a man of his word. I think he'll do it. I think he'll help reduce corporate taxes to help these companies come back. I mean, if your tax rate went to 15%, just think how much more money you would have in your pocket. If you were able to build more businesses where they're only taxing at 15% instead of 40%, it'd be a lot easier for those businesses to have a chance at making it and hiring extra people. That's the hard part of it. You can't compete. How do you hire somebody when you got to sit there and pay them? Well, they want to pay them $15 an hour. Well, that's fine, $15 an hour. But the problem is, it's $15 an hour. You can't have a lot of employees. People don't get it. If you don't run a business, it's like what I never understood. The players, NFL Players Association, they want to sit there and they want to have part ownership. Well, what are you going to have when they lose money? Are you going to cough up part of the cost for the stadium, the lights, the employees, the hot dogs, the beer that they have to buy, everything? Oh, when they need new AstroTurf, when they got to do is put in new goalposts, are you going to help pay for that? Hell no, they're not. They think they should only reap the good instead of having to pay for the bad. You know, who's going to pay to plow the parking lot of the stadium? Who's going to pay for the upkeep of the field? Not the players. And they go, well, the owners make so much. Look how much money they have at stake. Look how much money they have invested into the team. Do the players invest anything into the team? No. Do they put money in back into it? No. They take the risk, the owners, not the players. The players, all they have to do is perform. If they perform well, they get paid. If they perform poorly, they're not in the league long. But they think that they should get part of the owner's money. You know, you hear people going, oh, McDonald's, they make way too much. Yeah. The thing about it is they're in a business to make money. They're not in a business to break even. It's not a nonprofit organization. They're designed to make money. And if they don't make money, they close. You know, that's the problem with people don't think. They think that everybody should make what the owner makes. But they have no... stake in the game, as you want to call it. They don't have to worry about something going south. And let's say they do is they redo your road and it's closed and something for 2 months. It might cause access to your building. And they have to are they going to have to sit there and pay for the upkeep of everything? No. They have no idea what it costs to run a big business like that. They think that they should get part of the good and not have to help pay for the bad. Yeah, I've always seen that. Oh, they can afford a dollar across the board raise. Okay, with 1,000 employees, how much is a dollar across the board? Turns into a lot of money. It's over $1 million a year. Where do they make up that money? I had an individual ask me one time. He said, oh, the green fees, they should reduce them by $5 a round. I said, okay. I said, if we do 25,000 rounds, I said, where do we make up the 125,000? Oh, you'll do it in more play. I said, okay. So now we have to do like over 2,000 rounds more a year just to get back to where we were. So everybody has this great idea how to run a business, but they never have been involved one and never have put up any money to actually run one. It's easy to sit there and splurt out, yeah, they need to do this and pay that and pay me $15-$20 an hour. Yeah, well, yeah, the problem is mandatory $15 an hour, that means a kid that's working, 3 hours a day because he's, he goes to school or whatever it is, he's still going to make $15 an hour. They're not going to do is let's say you've been there for a long time and you're working at, let's say Walmart or whatever, and you're making $14 an hour. When they go, okay, everybody goes to $15 an hour, the guy that's starting is going to make $15 an hour, and the guy that's been there whatever how many years, he's going to make $15 an hour. He's not going to make $7 more than what the wage jump. He's going to go right to 15, and they're all going to be at the same. And they're going to, whoa, wait a minute, that ain't right. I've been here for 9 years or whatever. Oh, well, you're making more, aren't you? But, WikiLeaks is exposing a lot of the stuff that's been going on, that's been hacked. Oh, let's see here. There was a new article out, and I want to read that. It was about all the stuff that WikiLeaks has featured. That the mainstream media is kind of just ignoring. I mean, it's ridiculous. in the news, Republican GOP site was firebombed. And it had a swastika, and it says, you know, get out of town, Nazi Republicans. But CNN Don Lemon suggests, it wasn't Don Lemon. It was CNN host blames the firebombing on Donald Trump because his rhetoric. And I'm like, okay, yeah, it's his fault. Maybe it's because the people aren't tolerant on the left. I always thought it was weird that you can be tolerant of somebody's opinion, but if it's not the same as yours, you're not. They need to be a tolerant of my opinion. But if they don't believe the same thing I do, I'm going to attack them. It's crazy how our society has gone. So there is a Project Veritas. I don't know if you've heard of that. Well, Project Veritas was undercover. It was a video sting. And it was exclusive. It says, O'Keefe video exposes bird dogging. And I'd never heard the term bird dogging. It said, Democrats have used trained provocateurs to instigate violence at Republican events nationwide throughout the 2016 election cycle. Not just the Donald Trump rallies, a bunch of different rallies. If you go on to Breitbart.com, it's one of the first articles there. It's called Exclusive O'Keefe Video Sting Exposes Bird Dogging, Democrats' Effort to Incite Violence at Trump Rallies. And it goes through and you can watch it. They actually show video and they have everybody's name. They have Robert Creamer, who ends up, Creamer affirms on the video that Clinton is aware of all his work and the Democratic partners has a daily telephone call with Clinton campaign to coordinate efforts. O'Keefe and his team also obtained hidden camera videos showing one of Creamer's consultants, Scott Full, describing bird dogging and other tactics. Taking credit for having instigated violence at several Republican events during the 2016 election cycle. Full, who praises Creamer as diabolical, explains how bird dogging works, how they plan confrontations in advance, choose particular individuals to provoke and maximize media coverage. I watched a whole video. The video lasts it's close to 12 minutes or 14 minutes, and it has multiple different interviews where they're hidden camera interviews. It talks about incident where a 69-year-old woman wearing an oxygen tank heckled a visually impaired 73-year-old Trump supporter, then pursued him. She claimed he then punched her in the jaw. Though she saw no visible or had no visible injury, his attorney claimed she touched him on the shoulder and then fell to the ground as he turned around. The national media covered her claims widely or largely ignoring his. So that's the thing is they have the media behind him too, where the media, it's like a big setup. It's like that guy that runs out in front of the car and claims that the car hit him, and now he's suing because he can't walk or his hips broke or, you know, something like that. He's making up some story. Well, in the WikiLeaks emails, it said CHC op-eds calling on Republicans to denounce Trump's comments and praising HRC. Engage immigrant rights organization. Dreamers have been bird dogging Republican presidential candidates. It's right in the emails. Right in Mook's emails. So, which is Robbie Mook is Hillary's campaign manager, if you want to call it. So you look at it. I mean, they will do anything to win. They will, by hook or by crook, that's what they do. They paying homeless people to cause disturbances. They're all set up. There might be five people there. Four of them look like Trump supporters and one's a regular one. And they will purposely stage it. They will have somebody wearing a Hillary shirt or something or, you know, whatever. They purposely set the whole thing up. And they have cameras ready to do it. And they do it outside before it gets in. Because if it gets inside, then the Secret Service are in charge of it. Outside, it's free game. And the media will cover it. Once there's any bit of disturbance. See, that's the problem is the Republicans don't go to Hillary Clinton rallies and cause disturbances because they could care less about going to her rallies. Plus, the fact is there's only like, what, maybe 100 people there at most? There's hardly anybody going to it. So, yeah, it's crazy. Watch the video. See for yourself. I love former Mayor Giuliani's comments. He says, dead people tend to vote Democrat. You tell me there's not voter fraud going on? There was a mailman who was bragging about destroying Republican absentee ballots. I'm like, what is wrong with our country? That they think that that's good. That it's not that that guy should be fired. He should be arrested and charged and do serious time. Because it should be for both sides. I don't care. I don't think somebody should be able to sit there and destroy Democratic ballots or Republican ballots. But they're going to do everything they can to try to steal this. If it has to go with people, I think there needs to be two Democrat spotters or sitting at the polls and two Republican spotters at every polling place. So, I mean, it's there was a gun store ad. Prices will skyrocket if Clinton wins. Well, it's true. She wants to do is charge a 25% surtax. There also an email that came out that actually story that came out. I'm sorry, I don't know if it was an email, but it says FBI docs. It said Hillary was so unpleasant. Security agents didn't want to protect her. It said senior agents would do everything. It said during her interview with the agent said Clinton treated agents rudely and with contempt and were so unpleasant that senior agents typically avoided being on her detail. Explained that Clinton treatment of DS agents on her protective detail was so contemptuous that many of them sought reassignment or employment elsewhere. There's also a rumor that came out that they had made kind of almost a bribe to some FBI agents that, you know, if they, you know, kind of, I guess the ones that were investigating the case, that they could get nice assignments overseas or something like that. I'm like, what the heck is with that? And another one, this just freaks you out. It never stops coming. It's like this WikiLeaks dump just keeps piling it on. Bill Clinton, what did you get for your last birthday? Think about that. Friend of mine's birthday was just around. I don't know what he got. I have no idea. I wished him happy birthday. But Bill Clinton was given $1 million from the Saudis. What is that? Is that a hell of a birthday gift? And what do you think they expect in return? Nothing? Do you think they just go, we really like you, Bill. Here's $1 million. Are you kidding me? Who is naive enough to believe that they don't expect to get something back? They expect to be paid back in favors. And if Hillary gets elected, they'll definitely be paid back. Yeah, it's just... The Democrats are so dirty that... and people don't care. My slogan for the Democrats is, she came, she lied, 4 Americans died. That's what I think of her. It's amazing how people sit there and don't care about Benghazi. They don't care about all these WikiLeaks dumps. All these CNN and everything, they ignoring it. It just blows my mind that they just ignore. They will sit there and elect somebody as criminal as she is. This family needs to just ride off into the sunset, get rid of them, because they have sold this country out. She plans to have open borders, wide open borders. It's in the WikiLeaks emails. She wants unlimited immigration. She wants wide open borders. She wants America to be run by a one global power. That's what they are. They want to do is, they don't want to just rule the United States. They want to rule the world. They want to be the UN. There is a rumor that the UN plans on taking over and going house to house to try to take our guns. There was an interview from a gentleman that was from Norway. They were talking to him that he's been told that they'll eventually be going house to house to take our guns. You imagine the bloodshed that's going to be... I mean, there's going to be people that will not... The old saying, cold dead finger, and that's what they plan. They don't care. They will kill you. People have been head in the sand, don't want to believe what's going on for how long. And everything that they're starting to pump out about these, I mean, they've come out with all these allegations against Trump. Well, all these allegations against Trump are falling apart. It's funny how all of them happen to be somewhat similar. Some of the people that they made allegations that he had sexually assaulted them. It's funny how previous where they wrote him emails, glowing emails about how great a guy he was and how they'd like to work with him again. I'm sorry, when somebody sexually assaults you, you don't write him an email requesting for more employment. Yeah, I don't know, just too timely. And I feel bad for Billy Bush. Billy Bush lost his job because of a corrupt media. They held that story. They knew. They could have brought that out in the primary. Did they bring it out in the primary? No, because they knew they wanted to wait. So it was so late to where to try to create a backlash and firestorm. That's the only reason why they did it. You know, all the stuff Hillary does, well, all that doesn't count. And when they do bring it out, nobody wants to carry it. CNN won't cover it. MSNBC won't cover it. I said, just wait. You're going to find out that if she gets elected, I feel that we're done. This country's done, because they will just do everything in their power to destroy this country as a whole. So there's prisons are talking about how they're fighting with these drones that are having to combat these drones bringing in illegal drugs and everything. And you imagine they could fly over with weapons and stuff like that and drop them in. So, I mean, that's got to be just a daily occurrence. Also, this is a story that came out. And I'm like, why? I only got a few minutes left, but I want to do is this guy come out. Oh, I got two stories for you before we go. UFO expert found dead days after texting his mother. He says, he texted his mom, "Your boy's in trouble. If anything happens to me, investigate." Conspiracy theorist texted his mother to say, "If anything happens to me," days before his mysterious death. He says, Max Spires, 39, a father of two boys, was found dead on a sofa in Poland, where he'd gone to give a talk about conspiracy theories and UFOs. He's ruled to have died from natural causes, despite no post-mortem examination being carried out on his body. But his dark investigation into UFOs and government cover-ups may have made him enemies with who wanted him dead, says his mother, Vanessa. Says, in a chilling text to his mother just days before his death, he said, "Your boy's in trouble. If anything happens to me, investigate." So, you know, you think about somebody to make that, you know, they talk about his unexplained death, subsequent treatment by the authorities have left many online following convinced he was killed by government agents. Conspiracy theorists have long convinced that UFO chasers who get too close to the truth are bumped off by Secret Service or so-called Men in Black. On one website, Project Camelot, a blogger wrote, "The entire circumstances are suspicious, and I urge everyone to encourage the release of details about what really happened and call for an autopsy." You know, why not do an autopsy? You know, they talk about, you know, conspiracy theories with you know, chemtrails and all different kinds of stuff, and you get know too much. It says he says if it was true, another Craig Hewlett added, "If it was true what he talks about, then why would they kill him? Healthy people just don't get sick and die, they get poisoned." So, you know, you think if he's a young guy like he was, only 39, they would do an autopsy. So, also another news, this is the one I was talking about just a second ago, why would you do this? But I got two stories left. Not just the one I was going to get to, but I wanted to hint on, how stupid is this? Joe Biden to go on the news, and he's speaking at a podium and hints at cyber revenge on Russia. That if Russia, they might start their cyber attack on Russia as revenge for meddling in our elections. I'm like, who warns a country about that? How stupid is that? I'm like, what the heck? I tell you, we're very close to war with Russia. They have warned that it might come before the election. That's 20-some days away. I don't want to be in war with Russia. But they're willing to do that just so they can control. So, but the story I wanted to talk about was why this guy would do this. Guy eats the world's hottest chili, and the results were not pretty. You know, you think about that, you know, that ghost chili, or what do they call it? The ghost pepper, known as Butjolokia. I never heard of that before. is the most brutal of them all. One of the hottest chili peppers in the world is twice as strong as a habanero pepper and three times as strong as a cayenne pepper. And this man ate a hamburger filled with ghost pepper puree. Surprising no one, the man was admitted to the hospital after violent vomiting and severe abdominal pain. But what did come as a surprise at the doctors was 2.5 centimeter hole burnt in his esophagus. The man was forced to undergo emergency surgery and spent nearly a month in the hospital. I'm like, what the heck is a 47-year-old man trying to eat these ghost peppers? I mean, crazy. He says, there is no way. You know, I don't mind. I like peppers, but there's no way I'm eating something that's going to sit there and burn a hole in my esophagus. Spent a month in the hospital. No thanks. A month. So, coming up the debate Wednesday night, we got Donald Trump, Hillary Clinton. Donald Trump recommends, hey, why don't we take a drug test? He says, I'd be willing to do it. They're pumping Hillary up with something. Why not? So, that'll be interesting Wednesday night. Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. Cubs Dodgers from LA, 7 p.m. Central, 8 p.m. Eastern start. So go Cubs. Hopefully we can get 2 out of 3 at least and take it back to Wrigley and win it at home. So it is time for me to sign off. It is a great night, or have a great night. And we'll see you on Wednesday night, and there'll be more. There's just, it's constantly something more and more coming out. So, we'll see you on Joe Rocks on Thursday night. But everybody have a great night, great week. And like I say it if you say it. Say it if you see it. That's what I mean. And Hillary's new campaign slogan. She came. She lied. 4 Americans died. So, we'll see you on Wednesday. Let's see. What do we want to go out with? How about maybe a little bit of... maybe a little... Return of the Mac.